Hi friends, this is Manoj Prabhakar from Smart Leaders IAS. In this video, we are going to have a brief look into the editorials pertaining to economics that appeared on the Hindu newspaper during the third week of January. The first editorial which we are going to look into is the problem of plenty. This editorial is dealing with the vagaries of fluctuating prices of agricultural products in India, especially potato. We have witnessed the demonstration staged by the potato farmers in Uttar Pradesh, citing the drop in potato prices. So this price fluctuation has led to the farm distress. This farm distress has very huge humanitarian and political costs in a country like India, where the majority of the population is dependent on agriculture for as an agriculture for income. So this has a bigger impact on Indian agriculture. The price fluctuation has a bigger impact on Indian agriculture. The price fluctuation is majorly is a problem of non-synchronization between the demand and supply. One particular time the supply will be higher, the demand will be lower. When the trend changes, then the demand will be higher, the supply will be lower. Entwined between these bipolar fluctuations, the farmer is facing the fluctuations in prices. Potato conundrum. The potato price has plummeted in the potato growing states. Potato growing states are mainly in the northern Indian plains. I have added a picture in the slide. The picture shows that the northern plain states, mainly Uttar Pradesh, which has the maximum production of potato in the country. What is the situation now? The price of potato has dropped less than a rupee for a kilo. This is too huge. The farmers, looking to avert the loss, either let the potato to rot on the roads, and few rich farmers who have idea about cold storage facilities, they have opted for cold storage facilities. But even few reports suggests that the cold storage facility is too costly and it will not even cover the input cost of the farmers. So the cold storage has proved to be a non-viable solution when there is a supply demand fluctuation is happening. This present drop in prices have come after a huge price rise of potato, which was due to the scarcity of supply. So this has caused a conundrum. Few months ago, the prices of potatoes were higher owing to scarce supply in the market. Within the span of few months, the prices has come down, causing distress to the farmer. Even during last year, red chili, tur dal and tomato faced a similar fate due to higher supply in the market. This has been a recurring problem for Indian farmers. What the author is suggesting is that the fluctuation in agricultural goods supply and price has gone into a cobweb phenomenon. Cobweb phenomenon is a macroeconomic model which shows us the reason for fluctuation between the demand and supply. The author suggests that the fluctuation in agricultural goods supply and price can be explained through cobweb phenomenon. Cobweb phenomenon is a macroeconomic model which suggests the relation between the supply and price in the market. The recent GDP projections have projected the growth in agricultural sector to fall down from 4.9% in 2016-17 to 2.1% in 2017-18. This means slowdown in growth shows a direct link to rural distress. This present price drop has come in the background of a rural distress. This is going to worsen the matters for the farmers. We discussed about cobweb phenomenon, which explains the relationship between supply and price of a product in the market. Let me explain the cobweb phenomenon through a simple graph. Normally in mathematical functions, we have the independent variable on x-axis and dependent variable on y-axis. As far as macroeconomic functions are concerned, it's a vice versa. The dependent variable will be on x-axis and the independent variable will be on y-axis. So let's have the quantity in x-axis, the price in y-axis. Let's draw a demand supply curve in equilibrium. This is demand and this is supply. This point O is the point of equilibrium. So when the demand and supply is in equilibrium, there will be one particular quantity being grown. Let's mark it as Q0. When the demand and supply are in equilibrium, there will be a equilibrium quantity being produced. Let's mark it as Q0. and the equilibrium price, let's mark it as P0. Say when the supply is less, the first year, Q1, the supply was less, the demand was higher, and the price was also higher. That is P1. Expecting a huge price increase even the next year, farmer is enticed to supply more goods. That is point Q2. Since the supply is very high, the demand will be coming down, and the price, so the price, that is P2. See here, when the quantity was lesser, the price was higher. When the quantity was higher, the price was lesser. So with the based on the these experiences, the formula will go for quantity which is lesser than Q2 and which is higher than Q1, that is somewhere between Q0 and Q1. This is going to fetch him a higher price than P2 and a lower price than P1. The price of the product has increased. Again, enticed by this, the farmer will be growing higher quantity again. So again, this vicious cycle of fluctuation between supply and demand is going to happen. Again, the fluctuations in price, again, farm distress. So what the government should do? See, whenever there is an agrarian distress, the local government, say the state government, will move to many populist measures. Even whenever the big states are going for elections, the populist measures are always on the anvil. Say they will go for farm loan waiver, and they will announce high MSP for the agricultural products. This is going to have a huge impact on the fiscal discipline. So these ad hoc measures, which are going to give only a temporary solution to the farmers, are not going to work. What we need is a permanent solution, which is going to check the price fluctuations. This cartelization and lack of forward-looking contracts is pulling down the farmer's ability to increase his income and pushing him into distress. The government should look away from ad hoc, as we discussed earlier, the government should look away from ad hoc solutions and should go for an by introducing permanent solution. Only by looking into these factors and providing a permanent solution, we can ensure to double the income of farmers by 2022 as envisioned by Honorable Prime Minister. The next article, which we are going to have a look into, appeared on 16th of January. The title of the article is Social Security is Still a Raw Deal for Many. This article is a reflection of a report released by International Labour Organization. ILO, that is International Labour Organization, has released a report called the World Social Protection Report 2017-2019. We all know ILO is International Labour Organization, which was founded on 1919, and it is one of the successful ventures of League of Nations, and it's headquartered in Geneva. What does this report speak about? The report speaks about the importance of social security in the modern world. So this report can serve as a tool. We are all witnessing a rise in populism all around the world, and the results of this, the findings of this report, will help us to understand the reasons behind the growth of populism around the world. The report underlines that the goal of attaining comprehensive coverage of social security is still a dream for many countries. The report says that more than 4 billion people all around the world live without any safeguard against the normal contingencies of life. The normal contingencies mean, say, disability, either permanent or temporary, or death, old age. So I repeat, more than 4 billion people live without any protection for normal contingencies. The report also highlights that 45.2% of the global population are having only one protection against the gamut of risks they are facing. That is, they have a safeguard to face only one risk. That too, only 45.2% of the global population. Also says that more than half of the rural population in the world are not covered by universal health programs. I repeat, more than half of the rural population are not covered by universal health programs. And the situation is far better in urban areas, but it is not that rosy. Like only less than a quarter in urban regions, that is less than 25% of the people living in urban regions, are not covered by any universal health programs. And 29% of the population have comprehensive social security, which is very less. 29% of the population have comprehensive social security, and this number is growing at a very slow rate of 2% per annum, which is not a welcome sign. One important point to note is these social protection benefits are listed under SDG 1.3. See, social security involves spending by the government. Many of the governments unfortunately have a dilemma between fiscal austerity and social security, which is not going to help the cause of improving social security for the citizens. One positive point would be the growing political support for the public investment in social security. Also, there is increased understanding among the governments that this public investment is critical to 1. Eradicate poverty, 2. To boost economic growth, 3. To reduce inequality. I repeat, 1. To eradicate poverty, 2. To boost economic growth, 3. To reduce inequality. So, as we discussed earlier, the fiscal austerity measures roadblock the development along social security. The report has also recommended some alternative long-term mechanisms to ensure social security by provision of economic stimulus and productivity enhancing growth. And the framework for all these efforts is laid by Sustainable Development Goals. It was globally agreed to eradicate child labor by 2025. In order to check the progress made toward that goal, ILO undertook a study, and the report of that study gives us insight into some disturbing trends. Two-thirds of the children does not lack any social protection. See, lacking social protection from family means they are not, the family is not going to support them for education. See, which is going to push the child into a vicious cycle. Also, around 41% of the mothers of newborn babies does not receive any maternity benefits. Also, only 29% of the persons with, only 29% of the persons with serious disabilities receive appropriate support from the governments. The report's recommendation to include 68% of the people in the retirement age under any old age pension scheme is a good move. The findings of the report also suggests that the present support given by the people are not even enough to pull the people from the abject poverty, let alone to lead a dignified life. The support is not even enough to pull them from poverty. The author also suggests that the states, that is the governments, should take cue from Argentina, Poland and Hungary by moving out the pension scheme from the hands of private sector. I repeat, the author also feels that the state, that is the governments, should take cue from Argentina, Poland and Hungary to move the the old age pension schemes from the hands of private sector. Also, the author feels that one important highlight of the report is that the report is they lack proper mechanisms to calculate the impact of social benefits. And many of the governments rue the fact that they lack practical tools to assess the impact of social sector initiatives taken by them. So the author feels that the report has given them with a practical tool and guidance on calculating the cost of different social benefits. So this is going to help the governments in going forward with achieving the target set in Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. The next editorial which we are going to look into is titled as Face the Inevitable. This article speaks about the rise in bond yields, which has resulted in loss for banks. Let's have a brief outline how the bond yields affect the price of a bond, how the increase in bond yields is going to affect the profit of the treasury operations undertaken by the banks in India. The bond yields have spiked in the third quarter, that is the quarter ending on December of the financial year 2017-18, owing to the fear of fiscal slippages. The bond which we are discussing here is a government bond. Okay, what is the relationship between bond yield and the bond prices? They both are inversely related. Whenever the interest rate of the coupon rate of the bond increases, the bond yield comes down. And whenever the coupon rate is decreased, the bond yield goes up. Let's have an example to understand the inverse relationship between bond yield and bond prices. Let's consider a company which is issuing bonds, ABC Corporation. The coupon rate is 4% and the face value of the bond is $1,000. One investor A buys the bond of ABC Corporation at the coupon rate of 4% and with a face value of $1,000. So the another investor B, he waits for few weeks before buying the bond, and between this time the issuer raises interest rates to 6%. So in this point, the second investor is going to gain more since he brought a bond with a coupon rate of 6%. So he is going to receive $60 as interest every year. So the first investor, that is A, that A would be upset of receiving only $40 per year. So he would be planning to sell the bond. But the ABC Corporation is already issuing the bonds at the coupon rate of 6%. So there won't be much takers for the bond being sold by A. So what would he do? He will bring down the price of the bond. He would have brought it for $1,000. Instead, he will sell it for $650. So that the interest rate on the, that is a coupon rate on the bond, would be higher than the coupon rate issued by ABC Corporation. By this way, this illustration will show you the link between the price and the yield of the bond. So where does the banks come in? Banks in India are forced to invest in government bonds as a part of the statutory requirement, parking the money in government securities, that is bonds, and waiting for them to mature. It's not going to help the banks in getting any profit. So what will they do? They will have a separate division called Treasury Division. The main objective of the Treasury Division is to undertake operations on government bonds, and with that they try to make profit without any risk associated with credits. This increase in bond yield will be, as we discussed earlier, this increase in bond yield will adversely affect the balance sheet of banks. Since this difference in interest rates going to pull down the bond price, they will be facing some losses because of the treasury operations. The yield on 10-year government bonds have increased from 6.5% to 7.56%. This is a phenomenal increase. ICRA believes that due to spike in interest rates, the banks have faced a loss of 15,500 crores in the financial year 2017 and 2018. So the 15,500 crores is a huge amount. So the banks have requested the RBI to, considering that the loss is very huge, the banks have requested RBI to stagger the losses, that is to divide the losses between earlier quarters. Why do they want to do this? Because when every quarter they release their audited balance sheet, when they do that, when they show more losses, their share value is going to go down. This brings down the market credibility of the bank. So they want to stagger the losses between different quarters. And the other point is, even the yield of newly issued 10-year bonds, which should be maturing in 2028, even that has increased by 27 basis points. We already know that the banks are in a huge capital crunch. One, because of mounting NPAs. Two, because of insolvency procedures, for which the banks has to set aside 50% as provisioning. These kind of losses in the background of NPA and this insolvency procedures is going to be cause a distress for the banking sector. Since demonetization, the banks are flush with cash and the deposits are increasing, but the credit offtake is very stagnant. This is not going to help again. During last year, when the bond rates came down, the banks enjoyed windfall profit. Now when they are facing any losses, they are looking for regulatory forbearance. This is not the right solution. That's what the author feels. Then window dressing or any accounting chicanery. I repeat, window dressing or any accounting chicanery by the bank to make its account book look rosy, it will be at the cost of the financial strength of the bank. banks are always prudent in analyzing the credibility of the creditor. Apart from that, they should also be prudent in analyzing the market factors while undertaking treasury operations. RBI Deputy Governor Viral Acharya has criticized this particular stance of bank that whenever there is heads, I win, and tails, the regulator dispenses. That is, whenever there is a profit, the banks will enjoy it, and whenever there is a loss, whenever they are facing an adverse situation, they will look for the regulator, that is RBI in this case, to take over. This mindset has to be changed. That is what RBI Deputy Governor is feeling. So as we discussed earlier, along with credit operation, treasury operation also need proper accountability and proper management. Treasury operations in the bank are undertaken by trained professionals, and it is their duty to undertake prudent measures in treasury operations. The banks should look inward and they should find the real reasons for their loss rather than looking for the regulator for any solution. As we discussed earlier, any temporary measures to divide the losses across the quarters, it's not going to help in a long term. It is the right time for banks to wake up and to undertake prudent treasury operations. The next article which we are going to have a look in is Bitcoin's rally may be over. This appeared on 19th of January. Let's have a brief outline. See, we all know Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency. During last year, the Bitcoin's meteoric rise in its value. Now, the value of Bitcoin is fluctuating, and it is hovering around the mark of $10,000. So let's have a brief look into it. Price of the Bitcoin has lost half of the value comparing to the value in the previous month. So it was traded for $19,300 and now it has come down to $9,300, a phenomenal decrease of $10,000. And as I said earlier, the value is volatile and it is fluctuating around $10,000 mark. The skeptics of Bitcoins, this fluctuation in value of Bitcoin supports the bubble theory claimed by skeptics of Bitcoins. We have skeptics, we have the supporters of Bitcoin. The supporters of Bitcoin believe that Bitcoin has entered into a phase of consolidation from where it is going to rise again and it is going to have a stable value. This is what the supporters of Bitcoin feel. Bitcoin is unable to maintain its uptrend. Whenever the value of Bitcoin is going down, the miners, they undertake some corrective measures. These corrective measures to boost the value is just able to push it just above the previous low. That is, whenever they undertake any corrective measures, they are only able to push the value of Bitcoin just above the previous lower price. These high-low fluctuation in the value of Bitcoins indicate that this is going to go for a certain downward trend. This high-low fluctuation in value of Bitcoin certainly shows a sign of downtrend as in any financial security. The author has opined that the current pricing pattern of the Bitcoins, that is the short-term outlook, the short-term trend of the Bitcoins are going to continue even in the long term. That is, the fluctuation is going to be a permanent issue. The bearish trends in the value of Bitcoins, which we have witnessed in last month, paints a different picture of the monster that rose during last year. For any speculator investing in market looking for profit, he always has a golden period. The author feels that the golden period for investing in Bitcoins is over, and any imprudent investor looking for speculation by investing in Bitcoin will go short on the investment. See, the Bitcoin, even earlier, the value of Bitcoin has come down, and due to some corrective measures, the value has increased, and few believe that we cannot rule out the possibility of increase in value of Bitcoin in near future. Any currency gains its value by its usage as a medium of exchange. Only a few of the commercial establishment accept Bitcoin as a medium of exchange. This is not going to help the cause of Bitcoin either. And currency issuance and management is monopoly of the government. We can't expect any government to lose its monopoly over currency circulation and management. This is also not going to work towards the cause of Bitcoins.